Let us start the session. I am Professor Shashi Bhushan. Formerly, I was a principal scientist and the university head of entomology at PJT-ACIU. I had my doctorate in 1983 on pesticide residues, toxicology in agricultural entomology, and have 37 years of experience. And now I am the advisor for Food Hygiene Bureau, Jamaica, and also a freelancer and a consultant for in few companies. So before I start my lecture, which was exclusively meant for the PhDs in advanced course, I'd like to thank the Tutor's Pride and Tutor's Pride and the ITOP Awards for giving me the opportunity to speak here, and hope this lecture will be useful for people in the coming generations. For the topic which I was mentioning, is very important view of the present market trend on quality and exports and how care has to be taken by the farmers as well as the consumers. Let us go to the next slide. Pesticide residues and safe handling of pesticides. This is the topic on which I'll be speaking for some time now today. What is this talk about? How the students or the farmers or the consumers will be benefited by this? What are pesticide residues? What we need to know about them? Pesticide residues are the once a pesticide, a fungicide or a weedicide or a insecticide is sprayed on the crop, which remains on that for some time. How long they remain? So how we are concerned about the pesticide residues? What we can do to reduce that, to so that the risk is minimized, and who are the people who are all affected by the remnants of these pesticide residues on their crop or their food, whether we can utilize the pesticide for our advantage, and how to stay safe in spite of, because we have to live with the pesticides, there is no other go. Of course, organic farming is coming up. Still, many of the farmers still worldwide, they are using pesticides, so we need to go over with the pesticides. So what's the pesticide use pattern in India? If you see, from 50s, though initially government of India encouraged, it went to peak in 90s, 98, 88, 89, sometime, but later on dropped because of the BT cotton and other crops coming up, and then awareness on the pesticide residues, indiscriminate use of the pesticides, it's all become known to people. Awareness has come. There was a drop. But however, if you see from 2009-10, there is an increase again, because this is not due to the use of pesticides, the insecticides or fungicides, but farmers have realized how useful the weedicides, that is the herbicides, because the labor problem and other issues are coming up, and it's a scarcity, labor scarcity is there. The farmers have realized that we should go for the herbicides. Then if you look at the crop wise pattern in the country also, maximum is used globally also on fruits and vegetables. But in India, if you come to that, maximum usage of pesticides, if you see, it is on cotton. Cotton is having almost 45% usage of pesticides, followed by rice and then wheat. Rice, of course, 20% or 22%. And then other crops, 9%, plantations, 7%, like that. So vegetables, only 9% of the pesticides. Of course, we produce fruits and vegetables more than the agriculture crops in India. But however, the usage of pesticides is only 9% compared to cotton and the rice crops. Then how the pesticide cycle? You spray the pesticide. However, whole thing is not going to fall on the crop. There's a degradation by ultraviolet lights. Evaporation is maximum evaporation. Then once it rains, after the pesticide usage, it may get washed off, then surface runoff is there. Limited quantity of the pesticide will be remaining on the plant or the soil particles. Mostly it is degraded by bacterial oxidation, leaching below, runoff. These are the problems. Supposing you are spraying 100%, only maybe 10 to 20% may be getting onto the crop. That's why the farmers don't get the real benefits what exactly you think that you have sprayed. But then once it rains or because of the hot weather conditions, there will be a lot of degradation of the pesticide. Then how are the pesticides useful? You can see the left side. This is because of the using in the crops, or this is the industries use, or at home we are using this to control the mosquitoes, outside on the roads, etc. These DDT, bleaching powder are all tested. If you see the cattle or the poultry, the antibiotics or other things are given, particularly in animal use also, but to controlling the ticks and all, the some slight dose of pesticides are used. And sanitary use, of course, we will be putting the DDT or BHC and the bleaching powder on the roads and all. These are the other things how the pesticides are being used. Do you think all the farmers or everybody is reaching the extension officers or the scientists? No. A big no in India. These are the people, the dealers are the people whom the farmer approaches. We have been seeing for the last 35 years, 40 years, the farmer will straight away approach the dealer, a shop fellow, and ask him. And he will give a whatever pesticide is there on the tabletop, across the table, whether it is an insecticide or fungicide. Farmer is not aware, so the dealer will straight away give one of the things which has come into the market, saying that this is working excellently. This is the most unfortunate thing which has been happening in our country. Time and again, we train people. That's why this course is designed to create an awareness among the students and the workers, scientists also, that the farmer should be explained that he has to reach some extension worker or a scientist rather than going to a dealer. Because most of the time the dealers give whatever they have on table, and then again the farmer will come back the next day saying that that is not getting controlled. Again, he will be giving another chemical or a combination of the chemicals. These are the problems which the farmer is facing. Then if you see, what are the pesticides? Means any specified substance which is remaining on the foods, an agricultural produce or an animal, after spraying or application, and it converts, becomes a metabolites. Sometimes the metabolites are more dangerous, and they remain on the product for some time before breaking down, or the metabolites also. How long they remain, we'll see when we talk further in this class. Then we have done some work from 2007 on in the university and later on also. And these are the results from the government of India. Every month the samples are being analyzed by the government of India at different labs, and then the pesticides in the market or farm gate, etc. But we see that in spite of we giving technology, etc., then publishing books, the other things to the farmers, still many of the pesticides which are not recommended on these particular crops are being sprayed by the farmers on the crops. These are the problems. Many of the pesticides, now we have seen a couple of days back also, the government of India has banned 27 pesticides. Of course, the notification came in 2018, but now they said from June they are going to be banned, 27 pesticides. But if you see them, the particular the monocrotophas, the quinolophas, they have been banned long back, but still you find them in the market, extensively used by the farmers on vegetables, time and again on many of the crops. So if you see the pesticides in the market being used, and what are the recommendations? The Central Insecticide Board Registration Committee has, of course, registered more than 272 to 280 products. But if you see many of them, the products, if you go into their website and see the pesticides which are not recommended for those crops by the CIPRC, they are being regularly used by the farmers, and then they are using in mixtures, cocktails, combinations. This is causing a big problem. So I will not go more into the details of this, because number of samples are being analyzed. But if you see, out of 2,200 fruits in the market countrywide, 494 are detected with some residues, but only 25 of them are having a maximum residue limit. That means the limit which is allowed by the FSSAI or EPA USA earlier. Then why do we find residues on our food? This is the main thing. Particularly has been telling in the initial stages that the indiscriminate use of the pesticides, the waiting periods are not maintained. That means after you spray, you take brinjal, okra or tomato, the farmer will be spraying alternate days or every day, and the next day he gets to the farm, to the market. That is not maintaining any waiting periods or post-harvest dates. Like Before harvesting, if it is spread, there are limits that you have to wait for a few days, then get to the market. Those things I will give in the details later on. And then poor quality, inferior quality pesticides, or the pesticides which are outdated, the expiry date is over, and they are not kept, there is no shelf life for them. They are kept, particularly some of the botanical insecticides or the VTs, some of the products, they should not be kept outside, like the NPV, etc. But in the shops, they are kept outside because of the exposure to light, the radiation, the quality of the pesticide is gone. So then poor quality, that is. Then wrong advice and supply. Because the farmer is not reaching a scientist or an extension specialist or agriculture officer. The dealer, as I already shown in a slide earlier, they go to the dealer and the dealer says, because he is also not aware, whatever new product is coming into the market or given to him by a particular company, he says, you try to use this and we are giving excellent results. Elsewhere we have tried like that. Then effluent from pesticides in the market, manufacturing units. Then once the production is done, it is let out into the water bodies. There are procedures for putting them in effluents in a particular site and so that they are not reaching the water bodies, etc. But you see, many of the things, they are not taken care. Still, see, when we are analyzing samples, still we are finding DDT in the market samples. Where from? DDT was banned for agriculture use more than 20 years back. Still we are getting DDT. That is because Government of India has regularized use of DDT for medical purpose, etc., up to some 5,000 tons per annum. But still, this is being used for agricultural purposes, which is supposed to be given only in the health programs. Then wrong disposal of the leftover containers. Once the insecticide is over in the tin, it is just thrown in the field, left over there. The pit should be dug. It should be disposed of away from the field or water bodies, etc. But nobody takes care once the insecticide spraying is done. The empty bottles, the containers are just thrown in the field and that is getting out into the stream. Sometimes they use those same things, containers, for filling the water, transferring, etc. This is very dangerous. Then pesticide usage, how much pesticide is being used? What's the marketing going on? There should be thorough check on this. Otherwise, then you don't know where the pesticides are being used, on which crops, what's happening to them. Then post-harvest treatment. After harvesting, you have to treat the fruits and vegetables. That is called decontamination. I'll talk about it in detail. Then who are the people most vulnerable? Those who are involved in handling, loading. Exposure is the bigger problem. Then mixing of pesticides, the pesticide plants, the applicators, then the farmers, farm workers, the men, women, etc. And then wildlife. We have seen that there is a heavy extinction of the wildlife, particularly the honeybees. We are hearing regularly because of black aphid and some of the pesticides worldwide, particularly in Europe and America. And also the peacocks, etc., they are dying. The number is, then some of the very few birds which are remaining in the country, including the eagles, are all getting extinct. And then who are the people who are using this? The pesticides which are being used, they are reaching us, the consumers. And then the livestock also. We are spraying without knowledge on the grasses, on the field burns, the cattle are eating them, then the pesticide reaching into their fat bodies, through the milk again, coming back to us. Occupational hazards are a big problem, and also the people who are working in the field, the plants, they are getting more affected by this problem. Non-occupational exposure also originating from the residues in food, air, drinking water, etc. We have been seeing. What are the impacts of pesticides on the environment? Inappropriate use, already I mentioned, on the non-target organisms. You are spraying for a specific pest, but when you are spraying, because of the wind, the drift, it is going across to the adjoining fields also. There is no pest there. That crop may die off. Supposing you are spraying a weedicide here in your field, it is falling because of the drift is going on. Because now everybody is using the power sprayers, Taiwan sprays, etc. They carry the the stream or the pesticide to very far off places, quite some distance. So it is falling in the adjoining fields or on these streams or water bodies nearer to your field. So there is, if there is the crop which is there, cannot take up this pesticide or it is susceptible to this herbicide, the crop may die up. Like particularly you take the glyphosate. Glyphosate should not be used when the crop is there. But when farmers are using glyphosate to kill the weeds in their field, the glyphosate, because of the drift, it is falling in the adjoining farmers' fields, and we have seen lots of cases where the cotton or sugarcane crop, etc., died up. The water bodies are getting contamination because of the pesticide drift, because the speed at which they are going to the adjoining farmers' fields. Then air pollution, because of the volatile pesticides. The bees are getting killed because they keep flying some distance to get the feed for them, the nectar, etc. They come back to their beehives to prepare honeybee. But because of the, they are getting caught in the drift, they are getting killed, and then many of the non-target pests, plants are getting destroyed because of the herbicide drift, which I already mentioned. Then some of the crops, like, you know, you are using some herbicide which is not recommended on that crop, and then and you are unaware of it, and then you are spraying it, then straight away the crop is totally lost. Then high application rates, you are supposed to use maybe 2 ml per liter, that is 400 to 500 ml per 1 acre, that is 200 to 250 liters of water, but you are using more than a liter, because you buy a container or you are using lesser dose than the timings. The mornings we should use, not in the afternoons, or maybe in the evenings. In the afternoons, if you are using, because of the sun, the pesticide gets degraded very fast. So these are the things which have to be kept in mind: the type of the sprayer, the application methods. If you are using a herbicide, it should be on the ground, not using a powerful power sprayers, etc., because it is not falling on the ground. So the crop, whether it you are using on the crop or you are applying to the soil, these things you have to keep in mind. Then inhalation. We have seen lots of cases, particularly in cotton in some of the areas 10 to 15 years back, and last year we have seen in Maharashtra, because of the combination of pesticides which they have used and they inhaled, and then there was a toxicity, many farmers died there. And these are things which have to be kept in mind. The scientists or the extension workers have to brief the farmers and also the dealers. That's why these days dealer training programs are given quite often than training people, just like how to apply and all. These are the things which are given to the dealer and also to the farmer. Then we keep seeing quite often in the paper. I'm just putting this slide to make you aware that this is not correct. The press, media, they says everything is dangerous. In the initial stages itself, I have shown some of the pesticides are detected because of the gadgets or the equipment which we have, every lab has. They will be detecting up to very minor point, not 3-1 ppm like that. But the press, the channels, the media, they even once they get that hold of these records or reports from the Government of India website, they publish like this, creating panic in the consumer's mind. And then every day, so like this, you know, eating vegetables also is dangerous like that, and then sort of things, because here and there there are some samples which are detected with pesticide residues slightly above the maximum residue limit. That means the limit which is allowed, but it doesn't mean that every pesticide is very dangerous or it is in very high concentrations. Whatever food we are eating is poison, etc. It's not correct. Then the basket, the food basket, it is not the basket of poisons. There are some pesticides which degrade very fast. There are some pesticides which degrade after a couple of days. So we have to bear in mind when this pesticide was sprayed, but a consumer will not know about it. When it is sprayed, when it is brought to the marketer. These are things which are coming up. Then I was telling about the honeybees. Honeybees are going to get extincted from the world in few years. This is going to be certain issue. That's why every country is very much bothered about this. Then in Maharashtra case, already I mentioned 2017, 18, 2019, a lot of farmers died. So the government banning the pesticides, 27 pesticides now, they are banned only 2 days back. There was a gazette notification. And then what are the factors which cause problems. Main is the formulation. What type of formulation we are using? We are using a dust. What is the crop we have? Where it should be sprayed? That or applied should be borne. If it is a soil inhibiting insect, you have to use some formulation like a granules, etc. Like you have 4-8, the carbofurans and many granules. Now 4-8 nobody is using because of the bad smell, and then the natural organisms which are there in the way, microbes are all getting damaged by the 4-8. They are not using. What is the type of packaging? Whether if it is an emulsion liquid form, it should be in a bottle packed, or if it is a dust or a granular formation, it should be packed, repacked. And then weather conditions, whether you have rains, whether you are going to apply in dry soil or in the warning conditions, then plant protection equipment. Like the people using now present days for the corona, the personal protection equipment. Similarly, for an insecticide applicator, there are dresses which are meant, but if you see in the field condition, no farmer will be having because they are not having them. Then frequency and duration of the pesticide. What time you should apply? What should be the gap again for the next spray? And whether the same insecticide has to be sprayed or you change the pesticide? And how long the duration of the pesticide should be taken? It should be taken into mind. Then pesticide absorption. Normally the forearms, the palms, the groin area, they take the more of the pesticide. Also the forehand, the ear portion, the back of the ear, they take up the. Then the feet, because the feet are exposed, they also take up the most of the pesticides. The groin area takes 100% of the pesticide. That's why people who are involved in this, they get a lot of irritation, contamination in the groin area, skin infection. These are the things which commonly crop up. You can see on the forearms, on the palms, how without gloves, if it is palm, is the applicator is getting affected. You can see here. And then this is the kit which has to be used. The head protection, the respiratory protection, the eyes, the hands, everything. But unfortunately, nowhere any do farmer anywhere if you see in the fields. And they should have the readily the first aid kits also, because sometimes unknowingly you swallow or you smoke or have water during spraying, and then the pesticide must have fallen in your water, and then you take it, and there should be a first aid equipment readily available there. And then you should never try to mix up these fluids or spray near the water bodies like this, because you need water, but this is not the method to prepare these spray fluids. Then what are the types of nozzles? If you see on the upper side of the slide here, these are the types of nozzles which has to be, that means only at a flat position they will be falling on the crop, that is the weed sites. Then the contact fungicides, pesticides can be used using the flat pans or the hollow cones. So if it is falling at a distance with a fine this thing, that is a pesticide should be used, whereas cones are used so that the herbicide falls only on the soil where you are trying to spray it. Then the sprayer maintenance is the top priority. Quickly, because these are some of the corrosive parts or the plastic parts. Here, normally the leakage will be near the nozzle. The nozzle, if it is choked, the spray fluid will not be falling properly. So you should regularly clean the nozzles. Once a pesticide is used, you should clean it thoroughly. Particularly after using a herbicide, you have to thoroughly wash it 2 to 3 times. Otherwise, the remnants of the herbicide will destroy your crops once. These are the types. The hand compression sprays are being used, particularly for spraying the herbicides. This sort of things should be used. You should frequently inspect them, whether there is any leakage, the pump is hand spray, suction pump is working, the nozzles are properly working, the cutoff nozzle is working, the plastic parts, the PVC pipes, whether they are leaking. These things should be taken care of by a plant protection user. And then this is not the way, not at all. You should spray on the foliage, and if it is particularly for the BPH, etc., on the rice, you should spray on the hills, not on the top of this. But unfortunately, most of the people using these power sprayers, it will be going in a big jet or a big boom falling on the. So then what are the risk management pesticides? how they should be managed. You don't know what are the pesticides are being used by the farmers. Then what's exactly happening with those pesticides after application, because there is a compatibility, non-compatibility. The farmers are using combinations also. They may not be compatible. So antagonistic effects also are there. So we should see that a good agricultural practices are maintained by the farmers, then promoting safe use of pesticides, when to spray them, what time we should spray them, then the pre-harvest intervals. Means after spraying, how long you should keep in the field before harvesting, that is important. Then recommendation of the decontamination methods, which I told in the beginning itself. Then regularly monitor the agriculture produce for the pesticide residues. Then awareness programs to the farmers. These are the important things we should keep in mind as an agriculture scientist or a plant protection scientist. Then let us not go into more into this, because the codex is fixed up the pesticide MRL levels. Only for 71 pesticides, we have codex levels in India. Of course, the EPA of the USA and all. Though we have 280 pesticides, the MRLs are fixed for only 50 to 71 pesticides. Then they are not right on the other crops. But unfortunately, without keeping an eye on those things, we just recommend them that you can try on these crops also. Also, what is the maximum residue limit? That the residue of a pesticide which is can remain on the crop and using good agriculture practices, it is only a permissible limit. It doesn't mean that because the MRL is there, yeah, I'll try to eat it. We should be very careful. Then the good agriculture practices have to be maintained. Though the MRLs, etc., are fixed by the scientists and all, but a farmer or extension worker, you should try to encourage good agricultural practices for the recommendations which are there, etc. Then this is how to go over the calculations, acceptable daily intake and how MRL calculations. This I'll be giving you in the class as an exercise so that you can calculate for some of the pesticides which are being often used by the farmers, and you can do some exercise on this. Then set waiting periods. We have worked out for very long. You see some of the crops, the monocrotophagous. Now it is not at all recommended. Still farmers are using. You have to wait for 13 days if you are using monocrotophagous. The carbaryl is safer than fosalone. And many of the insecticides are getting faded out. And still farmers are using the faded out pesticide, and also lots of new molecules have come for which the MRLs are not fixed. Still people are using them. This is going to be a big task for the scientists, because they can't tell the farmer that there are no levels, that the information is not arrived, etc. But though they are not recommended for many of the crops, still the farmers are using them. Then how to remove the pesticides? Because we don't know what the farmer has used, what are the pesticides. So washing, cooking. Normally in India, we eat everything. We don't eat raw food. Everything is cooked, the vegetables. So just once you get them home, wash. Put in 2% salt solution for 15 minutes. Then remove and run, use running tap water, or using tamarind solution, or just washing with water also if you don't have soap, etc. Then for each insecticide, the decontamination percentage differs. Though you are using the same methods of salt water, tamarind water, or we are using the vinegar, particularly for removing the pesticides in cabbage, you can remove the outer leaves and also the cabbage or cauliflower in vinegar 1% solution, that is a glacial acetic acid. Like that, you know, particularly if you are grapes, if you see on the outer side, you find a fine covering of the pesticides being applied. So putting them in salt solution, whether the pesticide is used or not used, we are not sure. Put them in salt solution for some time, again wash them, remove them, and then wipe them and use. These are things. The how we are trying vegetables, fruits now during this corona period, the same methods which we have recommended long back. Washing and then cooking in pressure cooker, then cooking in outside normally, like our old methods, cooking in pressure cooker will remove 75% to 80% of the pesticides. So of course, I told you about the salt solution, how the vinegar can be prepared, etc. These are the methods which are commonly used worldwide. We have run lots of experiments during my service, and they have been very good results. So these are the simple things a farmer, a consumer, a common man can do. Use cooking, before cooking, washing with salt solution, running water, or put them in a pressure cooker. These are things which will take care of the pesticides. Then what are the points to remember? I'll sum up. So the what is the crop? What is the stage of the crop? You are going to spray on the fruit or the vegetable or on the plant for the leaves to control the pest, or on the soil. We should have in mind whether you have a sprayer, or if you are going for a granular play applicator, do you have a labor? If you are using a sprayer, do you have sufficient water, a labor? Then safe pesticides, the pesticides which degrade faster, have good impact on the crop, on the pest, but they degrade faster. They don't have the risk of getting developing resistance. That means the insect will be able to withstand the pesticide, that sort of thing. Then user friendly. That means the toxicity. If you see the insecticide containers, they will be red, orange, green, blue, like this, blue green. That is extremely toxic, highly toxic, moderately toxic, less toxic. The green ones are the phase one. Then environment friendly, that means with the low toxicity, the LD50 values are above 5000, like the melatonin or the some of the molecules which are there. Then the degradation is very fast in the environment, low mobility in the soil. They should not get mobile in the soil, leaching. It is going to be hazardous to the farms or adjoining farms. And then low application rate. These are things. And economically, they should be cheap, available for the farmer. These are the things we should have in mind. So yes, these are the few points I just wanted to tell you today. This half an hour to 40 minutes. And grow safe food, stay healthy. Everybody should be healthy, feeding good food. Thank you very much. I once again thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity today, particularly to the Tutor Pride group and the ITAP Awards people, and hope to be on your tutorial classes with my presentations on pesticides or the toxicity, and then the food wastage or food security, food safety, etc., which I am an advisor to the Food Hygiene Bureau of Jamaica, and also the Foundation for Agriculture and Sustainable Transformations, for which I am the advisor and secretary general. Thank you very much.